All right, let's get started. So let's do a quick synopsis of the last 3 weeks. Very quick, hopefully less than 5 minute synopsis of the last 3 weeks to bring us up to speed so we can better appreciate where we're headed right now. And basically what we covered for the last three weeks is from Sinai till the publication of the Shulchan Aruch. We have to talk more about the publication of the Shulchan Aruch tonight before we enter into the rest of the evening. But at Har Sinai, two major things happen. One is mass revelation, where the Ramban wrote that the significance of mass revelation was the fact that we actually heard the voice of God and that we heard the command of God. And whether it be for the first two commandments, all 10 commandments, but we heard the voice of God and the command of God. And Maimonides' approach, Rambam's approach, was that the significance was mass revelation and the fact that it affirmed for us the authenticity of Moshe Rabbeinu. The second incredible thing that happened at Har Sinai was the fact that we received the Torah. And we received the Torah. We'll just give the short perspective right now. According to the Rambam, what we received was the 613 commandments, plus the details that cannot develop further, meaning the things that cannot be argued about. We received the universally accepted details of certain mitzvahs. Some people entering the Zoom. Give me 1 second. Give me just a second over here. We received the universally accepted details of the mitzvot. And then we also received the principles to develop further the Torah further. We did receive the principles to develop for Torah further. And that includes, the Rambam says, things like drashos of expounding psukim, the ability to create rabbinic law, and also what ensued from there was customs. That was what happened at Sinai. From Sinai, we then entered into the realm of that elucidation and exposition and development of the oral traditions. That all occurred throughout from Sinai all the way until the Mishnayos were starting to be collected, which basically carried us through the time from Sinai through the destruction of both temples. And by the way, that's very significant that we didn't mention last time. Torah Shema Peh, the oral traditions, the expositions, the decisions, the enactments, all developed from the Sanhedrin that sat at the Lishkas Hagazis on Temple Mount. And it was, and part of the reason we cry on Tish B'Av was not just over the destruction of the edifice of the temple, but also the fact that the Beis HaMikdash was the source of Torah Shabbat Peh. It was the source of all development of Torah. Around the year 180, 190, 200, Rebbe HaKadosh saw that the oral traditions were starting to be lost and forgotten, and he wanted to create a system that was like the cliff notes to the oral tradition in order to keep alive the discussion. His goal was not to codify, his goal or create an encyclopedia. His goal was simply to create notes that are like mnemonics to help keep alive the oral tradition. Of course, he was very successful. They were among the Tanaim, who were those are the scholars that we find in the Mishnah. So they were the ones that were
before 135.
They were I forget the exact years of Hillel and Shammai, but they were around they're in the second century.
Okay.
Yeah, in the second century.
And why did destruction of the temple do away with Torah Shabbat?
The development further, because you needed the Sanhedrin sitting in the Lishkas Hagazis to develop. So there was some development, but that kind of mass production of Torah Shebaal Peh was lost. So that was the Mishnah. By the way, I should have mentioned last time, Rebbe wasn't the first to attempt this. Rebbe HaKadosh, Judah the Prince, when he compiled the Mishnahs, he wasn't the first to try and do that. Rabbi Elazar ben Yaakov, for example, already started trying to develop it. It was not complete. He had, you know, done just a few. And what Rebbe did was just adopted what already existed. So he adopted from Elazar ben Yaakov. There were a few Tanaim in Yerushalayim that were also doing this. Like the first chapter of Bava Kamma comes from, not Rebbe HaKadosh, but from another Tana in Yerushalayim. And this is what the Maariv Tzchias writes, developed the Mishnayos using some pre-existing notes that he included in his Mishnayos, but obviously Rebbe covered the entire breadth of the Torah Shebaal Peh, of the oral tradition. The Talmud then became the collection of the discussions related to the Torah Shebaal Peh, found in the, that's strange. Hold on. Everything's okay for everybody on the Zoom. It's just, I don't know why there's, yeah. I was, sorry, everybody, just one second. Everything's okay. Okay, we're back. So, so then what developed further from there was the discussions related to the oral traditions. Through the discussions related to the oral traditions, more law ensued from there. By the time that the Talmud had finished being compiled, it was around the year 500, 550 or so, from Ravina and Ravashi, who did it with a whole group of 50 Talmudei Chachamim, that then, according to the Gra, according to the Vilna Gaon, concluded the period of Horah, of being able to expound upon the Torah. Once that happened, so then that drew a line in the sand of Torah authority, that everything that came before the conclusion of the Talmud, before the publication of the Talmud, everything that came before then, one is not able to argue with. So we, after that period, are not able to argue with the Amoraim found in the Gemara, who were not able to argue with the Tanaim. The Tanaim were the source of Torah Shebaal Peh, so they weren't able to argue with them. And of course, neither of them are able to argue on anything that is a pasuk in the Torah, or those traditions that you cannot dispute, that we said are the universally accepted traditions straight from Har Sinai. This is, all of that is Torah Shebaal Peh. That is all Torah, written text, and the oral traditions contained within. All of that is from Sinai till the publication of the Talmud in around the year 550. From that point onwards, we now turn to application, where the Gemara will have multiple opinions on a matter. And those multiple opinions will sometimes be related to how you understand a Mishnah, or how we, or what opinion in the Mishnah we follow, whether it be in Torah law or rabbinic law. But what then after the point of the publication of the Talmud is now it's an issue of application. Well, what do we do? Right? Talmud had multiple opinions on this. So what do we do? So the Gaonim and then the Rishonim, there was a yeshiva called Gaon Yaakov that was developed in order to try and accomplish this in the time of the Gaonim, like Rav Sadi Gaon, Rav Hai Gaon. And then you have the Rishonim attempting to do the same thing, finishing the work of the Gaonim. And that really carries you from the conclusion of the Talmud around the year 550, around, let's say, the year 600, all the way until, we'll call it 1450 about, okay? Where it's trying to apply the Talmud, where the Talmud is rather confusing. We don't know what to do just from simply reading the Talmud. The Rishonim have a better understanding of the Talmud, and therefore using their each their own individual mesoras and how to crack the code that is the Talmud, told us exactly what to do. Now, there's really two types of Rishonim that you'll find. We kind of touched upon this last time. There are some Rishonim that you'll find that their job is to help us understand what's written in the Talmud. And then there's the other set of Rishonim that are there to apply which is written in the Talmud. So to tell us what to practice. So for example, you have Rashi. Rashi and his grandchildren, the Bali Atosos, their job is to help us understand what's contained within the Talmud, whether or not we follow those opinions. Rashi is there to help us understand, let's say, the opinion of Beis Shammai, equally like we are trying to understand the opinion of Beis Hillel, like we spoke about last time. Elu ve'elu divrei Elokim chayim. They're both true, right? Because they're both following different methods of elucidation that are both from Sinai. And therefore, there could be multiple truths that exist from the Torah. So Rashi wants us, in order so we can understand Torah, just to understand that on a metaphysical level, to understand Torah, we need to understand both opinions. We need to understand both sides. Regardless of how we're going to practice, we need to understand both sides. That's Rashi's job. Tosos's grandchildren also do the same thing. Tosos also has a school of application as well, like Rabbeinu Tam, one of the grandchildren of Rashi, also the Maram Rutenberg, also with a clear focus on the Re, with a clear focus on application as well, with practice and application as well. But then there's the other school of the Rishonim that their sole focus is application, like the Rith, who took the Talmud and condensed the entire Talmud into the bottom line Allah, what a Jew has to do. And he only focused on things that were practical in his day and age. We're talking about the mid-11th century. You have the beginning of the 12th century. You have the Rambam, who of course codified all of Jewish law. But again, he was just giving the practical bottom line. He wasn't focused on the opinions we don't follow. His job was application. The Rush, Rabbeinu Asher ben Yechiel, 1250 to 1327, also a sole focus on application. His son, Rabbi Yaakov ben Harash, also wrote the Tur that codified Jewish law in the practical halacha of what we follow, also with a sole focus on trying to apply that which exists in the Talmud, because we were stuck with a problem of that if a Jew wants to know what to do, you can't just open up a Talmud and know what you're supposed to do, right? Until what day in the Jewish calendar are you able to say Birchas Levana? Are you able to say Kiddush Levana, rather? Are you able to make the blessing for the new month? What is someone supposed to do on Yontif Sheni, on the second day of Yontif outside of Israel, even though there's a set calendar, right? These are things that you can't just simply open up a Talmud and just figure it out for yourself. So the Rishonim took it upon themselves to help guide us in that application. Fine. But now we come to the same issue, but it's now the new generation of the same issue, which is, well, we have the Rambam, the Rush, the Rif, Tosfos, the Rivash, the Tashbetz. We have all the Tur, you have all these opinions. So what are we supposed to do? Right? So if I'm from the town of the Rambam or the Ramban or the Rif or the Rush, if I'm from Toledo, Spain, I don't need to look anywhere else. I need to follow the Rashba. I know who I'm supposed to follow. I'm supposed to follow my rabbi, but I'm from La Jolla. So if I'm from La Jolla, none of the Rishonim are from La Jolla. So what am I supposed to do, right? So this is where the Shulchan Aruch came along and revolutionized halacha, where he said, now we're entering into a new world. That was the period of the Rishonim. We're now going to enter into the period of the Achronim. And this is an important distinction, how the Shulchan Aruch drew this line. Okay? Never had to say it straight out, but he drew the line. Okay? Yeah, Marty, before we go on to the Shulchan Aruch, because this is where we got up to last week.
So if I recall, Rav Karo
used
the Rif, the Rosh, and the Tur as his three.
The Rif, the Rush, and the Rambam.
And that's where he would pick whichever one there was a majority.
Yeah, so we'll talk about that right now. Okay? We'll talk about that right now. Okay? So here's where the Shulchan Aruch comes in and revolutionizes the halachic system. And he draws the line between Rishonim and Achronim, even though he actually doesn't use that expression, but we're gonna use some color commentary. The role of the Rishonim, as we just mentioned, was applying their Talmudic knowledge. They had a certain way of understanding the Talmud, and each one had their own style. They came from different yeshivas, they had different mesoras, different traditions, but they were applying the Talmud. They came with different interpretations of the Talmud, different applications of the Talmud, etc. Once the Rishonim did what they did, so now, after that, we need to look at it and say, hold on one second. The way that the Rush understood the Talmud, and the way that the Rambam understood the Talmud, and the way that the Rif understood the Talmud, and the way that Rashi and Tosfos and the Rashba and the Ritva and the Ramban, and the way that they each understood the Talmud is significant. Each one is significant. So how could we just ignore it and only follow one of their opinions? So it comes along Rabbi Yosef Karo, 1488 to 1575, and says, we need to come up with a system of how to practice law that is going to be fitting for all of Klal Yisrael. And he came up with the following system. And the system was that it is clear from the writings of the Rishonim, this is what he assumes, it's clear from the writings of the Rishonim and the way that they wrote prolifically on the different areas of the Talmud, that there's basically three of the Rishonim that stand out above the rest. And stand out above the rest for really the following two criteria. Number one is for the breadth of their writing, that they have commentary spanning the entire scope of the practical applications of the Talmud. And number two is not only their erudition, but the reverence that exists from the other Rishonim, from their contemporaries, from their colleagues. Those two conditions is what makes the following three Rishonim, the Shloshe, use the words of the Beis Yosef, the Shloshe Amudei Torah, the three pillars of Torah application, of Halacha. Number one, the Rambam. The Rambam codifying all of Jewish law in the way he did. Number two, the Rush, as we spoke about before, and the Rif. Those three are the Shloshe Amudei Hora, and therefore, says Rav Yosef Karo, let's take the following approach. We're going to follow the majority between the three of them if the three of them have what to chime in on a topic. If they have what to chime in on the topic, we're going to follow the majority of Acher Ab Mahatos, follow the majority of those three. If they do not have what to chime in on, or only one or two of them have what to chime in on, so that doesn't mean we're going to automatically follow that one. Rather, then we're going to take a step back and look at all the prevailing opinions, including the Rashba and the Ramban and the and Rashi and Tosfos and Rav Haigon and the Rabbeinu Hananel, etc., and the Rav Yan, and we're going to look at all their opinions and Trumas Hadeshen and come to a conclusion based on the majority of all the opinions. Take a survey and do a majority of all the opinions. And those two rules are going to be the rules of engagement in halacha of how one is supposed to know what to do. This is the system that Beis Yosef came up with. Not only that, not only is this going to be the way you're going to know how to paskin, but I'm going to write a book that outlines the entire scientific method and goes through the process, the scientific process, to the bottom line halacha, and that was called the Beit Yosef, this massive encyclopedia. The Beit Yosef, why is it called the Beit Yosef, by the way? It's called the Beit Yosef because the storehouse in Egypt for all the grain, for sustenance, for the Jewish people, for not just Jewish people, for the whole world, was called the Beit Yosef, because Yosef was the secretary in charge. It was the viceroy that was in charge of taking on the grave task of dealing with the famine, right? So he was the one that came up with the idea of making sure to store away the food, right? So Yosef HaTzadik bared the name of the Beit Yosef, was the storehouse that satiated really the entire world. during that period of time. So he said that the Torah is our storehouse. It's going to be able to satiate. It's called the Beis Yosef. And that there's also a Masorah that we have that whenever you publish a Sefer, there should be a hint within the Sefer to your name. The Shla writes that, that we have a Masorah like that. So he says, so my name's Yosef. So I'm going to call the Sefer the Beis Yosef because halacha is what sustains the Jewish people. And by the way, that's 100% true, by the way. Halacha is what sustains the Jewish people. I love history, but I know that history is not what sustains the Jewish people. There are plenty of other civilizations that a study of history was very important, but they didn't make it. The Jewish people are sustained through the study of Torah and the practice of Torah, through the practice of halacha. So the Beis Yosef is obviously right, that is what sustains the Jewish people. So he writes this massive encyclopedia of the Beis Yosef. He goes through, starting from Sinai, all the way through the Rishonim, till I think he published the Sefer in 1550, if I recall. Till that point, going through all of the entire line of the development of halacha from Sinai till then, coming with his scientific method of, right, he codifies all that, he brings all of that down for every single halacha. He then comes with his scientific method to tell you how to paskin. And he's upfront and transparent about all of it. That's the first time that anything existed like that in the Torah world, where someone sourced every single decision that they came to, and explained their scientific method as well. That's something that never existed before. It's due to that, that is the first reason why the Beis Yosef, and then you can't just have an encyclopedia sitting on the shelf because you get to the issue of it not being accessible. He wrote his index, the review system called the Shulchan Aruch, that he wrote as a companion to the Beis Yosef. That's the first reason that the Shulchan Aruch and the Beis Yosef or Yosef Karo were accepted as the halachic book, as the code of Jewish law for the Jewish people, was the fact that he came up with a scientific method, he was transparent of his entire process, and he went through the entire depth and the breadth and depth of every single halacha, how it developed from Sinai till that point in history. The second and arguably more critical reason why the Shulchan Aruch was accepted as the code of Jewish law is really a credit to not Rav Yosef Karo, but rather to the chief rabbi of Krakow at the time, Rav Moshe Isserles. Rav Moshe Isserles Zatzal was literally half the age of Rav Yosef Karo. He was born in 1530. In 1530, Rav Yosef Karo was born in 1488. Born in 1530. Unfortunately, he died 3 years prior to Rav Yosef Karo. The Rama, Rav Moshe Isserles, only lived 42 years. He was born in 1530, died in 1572. Lived a very short life. But in that short period of time, he, of course, became a major halachist. Not only did he become a major halachist, but he also saw the same issue as the Beis Yosef, as Rav Yosef Karo, and was also developing his own system, just like the Beis Yosef, literally, almost like a very, very similar book, very similar book. The only difference between the two books was who the Rama considered the Amudei Hora, those pillars of halachic decision making. He also included traditions of the Ashkenaz community, like from Maram Rutenberg and from the Maharil, the Sefer Minhagim, was the major contribution to the difference between the Rama and Rav Yosef Karo. And he was also writing a similar book called the Darkei Moshe. When he saw the Beis Yosef, though, he said, Jewish people don't need my Darkei Moshe. There's already a Beis Yosef. They already did something that he did it better than me, is what he said. So he did it better than me. So what he did with his Darkei Moshe, he took it, he put it in the desk drawer. Said nobody needs it, which is just incredible. He had an entire, imagine writing an encyclopedia and not publishing it, right? He just put it in a desk drawer. The humility of the Rama is incredible. And then he said, so here's what I'll do. I'll just write annotations to the Shulchan Aruch that he did a perfect, he did a beautiful job. He's just missing some Ashkenaz custom. And if we're going to really make this the book that's accepted by all of world Jewry, so then it also needs the Ashkenaz customs that may differ from the halacha slightly. So he includes the opinions of the Maharam of Rittenberg and also the traditions of the Maharil contained within others, contained within the Ashkenaz communities. And that was published together with the Shulchan Aruch. So the Shulchan Aruch published together with the Ramah, that is more than an endorsement. It is an endorsement and approbation. It's a confirmation to the entire Ashkenazic world that this is the book. That's the second reason why the Shulchan Aruch was accepted, and perhaps more prevailing reason why it was accepted, was because of the fact that it had this endorsement from the Ramah and those Ashkenaz annotations to the Shulchan Aruch as well. So that's why it always gets to me a little bit when people say, you know, the Shulchan Aruch is a book for the Sephardim. No, it's absolutely not true at all. It's absolutely not true. Moshe Isserles would disagree with you. It's not that the Shulchan Aruch is giving the Sephardic opinion, the Ramah is giving the Ashkenazi opinion. No, it's that the Shulchan Aruch is for everybody, and that there's some occasions where the Ashkenaz custom is a little different, and the Ramah will bring in that difference. That's all it is. That's all it is. So, and in fact, the publication of the Ramah's annotations came with the following title: the Shulchan Aruch, the set table, the Shulchan Aruch, the set table. The Ramah's book is called the Mapa, which is the tablecloth. So it's the tablecloth to the set table. All right. So now it's really a credit to the Ramah, of course, of Yosef Karo, this revolution of one source of Jewish law. Was it ever published? Yes, it was. It was published posthumously. And thank God it was, because as I mentioned before, there are things that were in the Darkei Moshe that are not in the Beis Yosef, and even things that are in the Darkei Moshe that the Ramah did not include in his annotations. So that we've actually gained a tremendous amount from the Darkei Moshe, being that it was ultimately published. Okay. So now we're on to the new category of Jewish tradition, which is the next era, which is called the era of the Achronim. Now the exact year in which the Achronim began is an impossible line to draw. Because basically it was from the publication of the Shulchan Aruch, but who in the Ashkenaz world at that time that the Shulchan Aruch was published was still attempting to accomplish what the Rishonim did, which was looking just simply at the Talmud and developing the halacha from there. And the way that happened in the Sephardic world is basically the Sephardic world adopted the Shulchan Aruch a little bit quicker than the Ashkenaz world. So you still had some Ashkenaz Torah scholars that would be considered Rishonim even after the publication of the Shulchan Aruch. They do draw a line here, but like for me, for example, let's see. Who would fall under that? Like the Marshal, for example, Reb Shlomo Luria. It's hard to call him an Achron. It's hard to call him, which we'll define what an Achron is in a moment, but it's hard to call him an Achron. He really wrote like a Rishon. He wrote like a Rishon, really just working within the Gemara and trying to understand the Gemara. And then you have some even Rishonim, quote unquote, that in this chart will example put them as a Rishon, but not really Rishonim. They talk more like Achronim, like for example, the Trumas Hadeshen, Rav Moshe Isserlin, really writes more like an Achron than he writes like a Rishon. But let me define what an Achron is, okay? So those are the outlying cases. What's an Achron? An Achron is now similar to the Rishonim in that what did the Rishonim do? They were attempting to apply that which is contained in the Talmud. The Achronim now are applying that which is contained in the Rishon. So they are looking at it and they say, well, we have now a baseline. The baseline is the Shulchan Aruch. But the Shulchan Aruch is not exhaustive. There are certain things. I'll tell you two sections of Halacha that are curiously left out of Shulchan Aruch. One is the laws of Lashon Hara. Not contained in the Shulchan Aruch. Laws of Lashon Hara. Number two, and this one's probably even more astonishing, Shemitah. The laws of Shemitah. And there were Jews living in the land of Israel at the time. It's not like it was a lost practice. There were Jews living in the land of Israel at the time. And therefore, it was still practical. Laws of Shemitah are not in Shulchan Aruch. So the Achronim now, what their role is they are going to come along and say, the Rishonim already figured out the Talmud for us. We now know, we now have to apply what the Rishonim had given to us. Now we need to apply it to the halacha, practically what to do. And even in the areas of halacha that we don't necessarily practice today, still even laws of like karbanos, of offerings, still we're going to not focus on the strict analysis of the Talmud, but we're also going to consider in our analysis the words of the Rishonim that came before us, okay? So that is what the role of the Achronim were. That's why you'll find sometimes that, let's say like Rav Moshe Feinstein. Rav Moshe Feinstein will sometimes argue on the Shulchan Aruch, or he'll argue on the No Debi Yehuda, or he'll argue on Rabbi Kiva Eger, some of these great Achronim. And the reason is because, well, he's looking at it and saying, listen, I have the right, because it's not like that I'm arguing on the Talmud. I'm sticking within the realm of proper halachic decision-making, but I'm looking at the Rishonim myself, and I think that you, Rabbi Kiva Eger, as difficult as that is to say, but you, Rabbi Kiva Eger, you know the Behuda, may have missed a detail that I picked up on, and therefore I have to be confident in the halachic process to say that this should be the correct halacha. It developed way before then, already in the early commentaries on the Shulchan Aruch, the Shach, Reb Shapsi Cohen, who also lived a very short life, only lived 40 years. It was alive during the Chelmanitsky riots. Spent his life on the run. But while he was on the run, he wrote probably the most impactful commentary on the entire Shulchan Aruch. You have the Prima Gadim, Reb Yosef Ta'omim. You have Reb Avram Gobiner, the Magen Avram. These are all commentaries on the Shulchan Aruch, which are basically saying, you know what? Let's, number one, try and figure out what the Shulchan Aruch is saying, but more often what they're doing is they're saying, maybe Rabbi Yosef Karo missed something here, or maybe I'll defend Rabbi Yosef Karo in something that others think he may have missed, right? And making sure that we're going to keep hold of this true code of Jewish law and continue to apply using a similar system of Rabbi Yosef Karo. So these are all of the commentaries you'll find in the Shulchan Aruch. And basically that's how you get from the Shulchan Aruch to how we practice halacha today, where it gets to, and we'll talk about this in just a second, but it gets all the way from that point onwards, going down now, further down the mountain to the Shulchan Aruch, and then to the Shach, the Taz, the Vilna Gaon, the Netziv, getting to even modern day postgame, right? In the last 100-150 years, Reb Chaim Soloveitchik, the Chafetz Chaim, you have Rav Avadi Yosef, Rav Eliashiv. All of these great postgame are all just applying that which is contained in the Rishonim, either following a similar system of the Shulchan Aruch or following a little bit of a nuanced system, but nevertheless trying to apply it into the practical bottom line halacha today, not going back a step and reanalyzing the Talmud, but using the words of the Rishonim and applying them appropriately. When Rav Moshe Feinstein passed away, so Rav Eliashiv Zatzal, who passed away in 2012, Rav Moshe Feinstein passed away in 1986, but when Rav Moshe Feinstein passed away, so Rav Yosef Shalom Eliashiv Zatzal, made a statement that I think shook the Jewish world a little bit. He said that we've now come to the end of the era of the Achron. We've come to the end of the era of the Achron, which, based on our definition of the Achronim, we can understand that at the time. Because our definition of the Achronim is applying the Rishonim, not just simply looking at Shulchan Aruch, not just collecting different opinions, but analyzing the words of the Rishonim and then applying it based on your analysis. Similar to like what Rabbi Yosef Karo did. So Rabbi Moshe Feinstein was doing what Rabbi Yosef Karo did. Like when you got an issue that, when an issue came to Rabbi Moshe's desk that is not explicit in Shulchan Aruch, well, what do you do with that? So you have the heavy responsibility to do what Rabbi Yosef Karo did for 99% of the issues. So now you got an outlier, an outlying issue that was not specifically addressed by Shulchan Aruch. Now you have to go back and do what he did by looking at the Rishonim and seeing how to apply this issue, how to deal with this issue.
Nobody else could, after that, that he was sort of...
Yeah, he wasn't just looking to see what others before him had did, but he was saying, well, now this is an issue that maybe none of them had dealt with straight up, right? Directed specifically at this issue. Let me try and think of an issue that is not explicit in Shulchan Aruch. Okay, we were just talking about one this morning. Literally just one this morning. It's not, and it's not a new age issue necessarily, but it's just something that was not explicitly dealt with in Shulchan Aruch. I was just talking about this morning, someone misstepped and they said the Birchos HaTorah out of order. They said their blessings on Torah study, where there's two of them. You make the bracha of Allah Asok B'Divrei Torah, and then you make the bracha of Asher Bachar Banu, and someone said them out of order. So now that you've said the blessing of Asher Baruch Habanu, is it too late and you can't say the first blessing anymore? Or should you say them out of order and now you should say the second blessing? The first blessing, now second. So that's just an issue that's just, it's just not explicit in Shulchan Aruch. Okay? So someone asked, someone sent the question to Rav Moshe saying that I did this, what do I do? Okay, so let me open up Shulchan Aruch and see what it says. Oh, it's not there. So I have to look at the Rishonim and I need to reanalyze the whole sugya. I need to reanalyze the whole issue at hand, the whole topic, in order to get to the bottom line halacha on this issue. This,
what I was sort of asking, but why would he say that it ended then with Rav
Moshe? Oh, so why did Rav Eliyashiv think it ended with Rav Moshe? So the reason is because already at that time, what was popping up was the next era, which we'll talk about in a second. But Rav Moshe was really the last one, at least in Rav Eliyashiv's perspective, was really the last one who was analyzing halachic issues still by looking at the earlier sources, not just looking at Shulchan Aruch and collecting opinions, but doing his own analysis of the Rishonim to come to the bottom line halacha. Like, it's almost like he himself, similar to like the contemporaries of the Shulchan Aruch, were saying, We're not reliant completely on the Shulchan Aruch. We're still going to analyze the topic ourselves. Rav Moshe Feinstein was doing the same thing.
Did he write a codified volume?
No. He just collected his response in the Igros Moshe, in the letters of Rav Moshe Feinstein. So that's what Rav Eliyashiv thought. Now, Rav Eliyashiv, I think, was also speaking a little bit from a place of humility, because in my perspective, Rav Eliyashiv was probably the last of the Ashkenaz Achronim. Rav Avadi Yosef was probably the last of the Sephardic Achronim. But we're right now in a place where that era is really really behind us. Now, that doesn't mean that every so often you'll find the posek that is going to deal with certain issues like that, like Rav Shechter Shlita. Like Rav Shechter Shlita will sometimes, when the situation begs of such, will put on his Achron hat and deal with the issue like an Achron. But more often than not, when you ask Rav Shechter a question, he'll respond by saying, oh, there's a tshuva in Rabbi Kiva Eger that deals with this, or there's a Pischei tshuva, or there's a Nod B'Yehuda, or there's a Rav Moshe Feinstein, or Rav Eliyashiv with that, or Rav Belsky, or Rabbi Soloveitchik. Like, he'll give the answer from the perspective of, this has already been dealt with, and I'm going to tell you what it is. In fact, it's not only to this point. That was something that already existed from the Achronim as well. Like the Avnei Nezer, the Sukachev Rebbe, who passed away in 1910, born 1838 to 1910, Rav Avram Bornstein, who Rabbi Soloveitchik referred to as a super genius, has a tshuva, what the role of a rabbi is today. His or tshuva, what responsible, what the role of a rabbi is today. And his first thought is the Paskin Shilas, to deal with the issues at hand, right? The halachic issues. And then he says, no, that's not the role of the rabbi today, because all that's already been dealt with. It's already dealt with in the Shulchan Aruch and the Shach and the Taz and the Vilna Gaon, and it's already been dealt with. So that's not the role of the rabbi today. So there he has a different perspective. What the role of the rabbi is to create peace. And it's like the role of the melech is to create peace. But even he already, you know, tips his hat, and he was an Achron, but he already tips his hat to say that we're just applying halacha today. We're not developing it further. It's already been worked out in Shulchan Aruch. It's already worked out. It's just a matter of application at this point. How the application takes place is there's a difference between the Achronim, which are applying the Rishonim, are applying the halacha in a creative fashion, versus what we're doing today. Now, what are Rabbanim and great Gedolim doing today? So here is what we're referring to. I once heard this from a Chavrusa of mine that I think he captured it perfectly. He called this era, a Chavrusa of mine, Rav Shmuel Kresh Shlita, lives in Detroit now. He called this era the Dor Hamalakdim, the generation of collectors. We're collecting opinions. We're collecting opinions. If someone asks me a question, so I can't just say Rav Moshe paskind as follows, and therefore it's either not okay or okay. It's not enough for me to do that. What am I responsible to do? I'm responsible to look at all the other opinions, because my shoulders are not as broad as Rav Moshe's or as the Noda Yehuda's, as Rabbi Akiva Eger's, and to be able to give an opinion just based off of, to give a psak, to give a to give over a halachic statement just based off of one opinion or just my opinion. I have the responsibility to survey and look, like similar to like Rabbi Yosef Karo did with the Rishonim, is basically what we're doing today with the Achronim, and looking at what Rav Yashu says, Rav Moshe says, look at all what all the Achronim had to say to come to the bottom line halacha. And that's why we're now today in the Dor HaMalachim, the generation of the collectors. And Rav Ovadia already started this a little bit. He already, even though he himself was a very creative posek, so he kind of like fell into both camps. He was an Achron and probably also a Malachite. But that's where we are right now. That's where we are right now. And that is like with someone, you know, like, for example, you know, people will say, like, you know, like, how did we get to the point that now, you know, from Har Sinai to the point that now, you know, I have to wait 6 hours between eating meat and milk, but my Yeki neighbor only has to wait 3 hours, and then my Dutch neighbor only needs to wait an hour. Like, how is that? Like, first of all, why waiting at all? Well, it says in the Torah is, you just don't eat meat and milk together. That's not even what it says in the Torah. It says in the Torah is, according to the Torah law, you can't eat meat and milk together that was cooked together in the way that it's fashioned to be cooked together. So anything less than that, why do I have to follow anything less than that? So now, based on this whole analysis we just gave, to understand how the halachic system developed and how it works, and that it's not that we are making up new things as we're going along. We're not making up new things. We're constantly reanalyzing and reapplying that which already exists. It's just an application process. It's an application of a process, of a system that was developed at Har Sinai. And it's just applying it still today. The system hasn't changed at all. It's the exact same system. It has not changed one iota. Not one iota. From Har Sinai till now, the exact same system that is being applied in the exact same way. It's an incredible thing. It's an absolutely incredible thing. That's I was just listening to a podcast, a Jewish podcast that happened to feature Ben Shapiro, and he threw out a line that was really very profound, that he said that, and it's really, it's a Rashi al Torah, but the way he said it was said very, very well. Rashi al Torah writes, maybe I should send him the Rashi, he'll appreciate it probably. But Rashi al Torah in the Song of the Sea, it says in the Torah, "Zeh keli ve'anvehu Elokei avi ve'aromemem." This my God, and I'll glorify him, the God of my fathers, and I will exalt him. Rashi says, what is the significance of Elokei avi? Rashi says, "Lo ani tchilas hakedusha." Kedusha, holiness, having the kedushas Yisrael, being sanctified as a member of the Jewish people, does not start with you. You are not in a vacuum. You're not the first in the chain, and you're not going to be the last in the chain. This is the way now Ben Shapiro said it. You're not the first in the chain. You're not the last in the chain. You're somewhere in the middle of the chain. You better make sure you're a very strong link in that chain, or the whole thing's going to break, right? That's what we are. It's the exact same chain that started at Har-Sinai. Chains are being added on in the exact same way it started being added then. Moshe Kippur Torah, Misinai, Maser Yehoshua, gave it over to Yehoshua, gave it over to the Zekanim. And that exact way that the Mezorah was given over then, it's exactly the way it's being given over right now. That is something that is just incredible. It's just incredible. It's mind-blowing. Absolutely mind-blowing. So this is hopefully a better appreciation of how the halacha developed. And we didn't even touch on, like, you know, so then how is it that I come personally to my halachic decision making, right? Like, how does Rabbi Reich in La Jolla tell his congregants what to do? How does my Rebbe play a role in my halachic decision making more than, like, does Rav Schechter have more clout in my halachic decision making than Rav Moshe Feinstein or the Nodeb Yehuda, Rabbi Kiva Eger, right? That's a whole discussion of itself, of a question of psak, of how the development of psak takes place, which is a different discussion, but we'll have to come back to another time. But it's all within how those details work are already in Shulchan Aruch, which means that it's part of the same system of law, right? It's all just part of this exact same system of law that started at Har-Sinai, that didn't ever change, and it's just a matter of application. So the way I'm going to give over my psak is really information. It's not a psak. We shouldn't even use the word psak. It's information. How I'm giving over information of halacha is already outlined for me in Shulchan Aruch, how me, myself, in my particular rabbanus, am supposed to give over that information. And everyone is going to be a little different, which is why Rabbi Reich is going to be a little bit different than Rabbi Gopolsky, who's going to be a little bit different than Rabbanim in New York or in Cincinnati or in Israel. Everyone's going to be a little different because we are following, but we're all following the same principles, which are already contained within Shulchan Aruch, which is all part of the same chain leading back to Har-Sinai. That's the halachic system. Okay. All right. Shkoyach, everybody. Okay. Housekeeping notes. The next 2 weeks we're off. Okay. All right. Good. All right. We'll stop here.